Macmillan Audio presents The Rise, Kobe Bryant and the Pursuit of Immortality. Written by Mike Sielski. Read by Mike Sielski and me, Landon Woodson.
Hey, this is the author, Mike Sielski. Just wanted to jump in and read the preface before handing off the rest of the book to your narrator, Landon. Preface. The Signs of Things to Come. On the day after Kobe Bryant died, a high school classmate and friend sent me an email that carried the force of a fist that I couldn't see coming. "Thought you'd find this interesting," Ben Rellis wrote. Embedded in the message was a link to a 36-second video. On the right side of the video's split-screen shot was Kobe, wearing a charcoal scoop-neck sweater, sitting in an expansive cherry desk, riveted to flickering images on a laptop. He was in the executive offices of YouTube, where Ben was working to find new content for the channel. Kobe had come to the company's Southern California headquarters in January 2018 to pitch a show based on Wizenard, a series of children's books he had created that combined the themes of sports, fantasy, and magic. As it turned out, YouTube wasn't funding children's programming at the time and didn't buy the show. But it was genuinely one of the most impressive pitches I've heard, Ben said later. He was incredibly passionate about the idea and clearly hands-on in every aspect of it. On the video's left side were the images that had grabbed Kobe's attention. Footage of a basketball game between two suburban Philadelphia high schools, his alma mater, Lower Merion, and mine, Upper Dublin. Ben and I were seniors then. He was a backup forward on the team. I was an editor of the student newspaper and lacked the skills and athleticism to play organized ball beyond intramurals. Kobe Bryant was a freshman. It was the second game of his high school career. On December 7, 1992, as part of its high school boys basketball preview package, the Philadelphia Inquirer had published a pair of brief articles, one about each team. Both squads were green and were expected to struggle. But according to Jeremy Treatman, the correspondent who had written about the Lower Merion Aces, one player represented a glimmer of hope for them. Remember this name, Kobe Bryant. The following week, the teams squared off in the consolation game of a four-team tournament at Lower Merion. In that 36 seconds of footage from that game, the Upper Dublin player closest to the camera, a senior guard named Bobby McIlvain, the number 24, also Kobe's number, huge on the back of his red jersey, whipped a cross-court pass to a teammate, Ari Grice. After Grice caught the ball in the right wing, he used a left-handed dribble to surge past Kobe and bank in a floater from the lane. A family friend of Ben's had filmed the game, and Ben, having kept the tape all these years and knowing he would be sitting down with Kobe, had converted the recording to a digital file. Then, once the YouTube meeting had ended, Ben had played the footage on the laptop, and one of his coworkers had taken care to capture Kobe's reaction to it. There it all was, in cosmic juxtaposition. You could watch Kobe as a 39-year-old watch himself as a 14-year-old in real time. "That is hilarious," he said. "Great defense, Kobe. That's horrible defense. You can replay that all fucking day. Oh my God. No, that's funny. We only won four games that year." So where were you when that helicopter slammed into that Calabasas hillside in January 2020? Fixing yourself a midday snack in the kitchen? Relaxing in your recliner? Cleaning the garage? Me? I was in my car, my two sons in the back seat, hustling home so my 8-year-old could change and get to his 3:45 basketball game. And when we got there, I didn't notice it, but my son did, and he didn't tell me about it until after the game. There was a player on the opposing team, his arms peeking out like sapling branches from underneath a white t-shirt and a green tank top, the word Kobe written in black marker on his sleeve. You don't forget a day like that. You don't forget a death that causes the global compass to tremble. That was Kobe Bryant's reach and power. We attach so much to our athletes. We see what they have done and can do. That's their gravitational pull, the attraction they have to us. They give us a standard to aspire to, a bar against which the rest of us can measure ourselves. And with Kobe, that pull was even stronger, because he was not limiting himself to basketball. He had been the executive producer of a short animated film, Dear Basketball, that had won an Academy Award and was based on a poem he wrote when he retired. In his post-Lakers life, he was, by all appearances, a loving husband to his wife, Vanessa, and a doting and demanding father to his four daughters. With time, with the media and fan base willing and eager to forgive, with the purchase of a gigantic diamond ring for Vanessa, he rendered the scandal that once stained his reputation, a rape accusation and his arrest in Colorado in 2003, an afterthought to most, though not all, of the public. He had put aside his petty wars with Phil Jackson and Shaquille O'Neal. There seemed great things ahead for him, things beyond the five championships and the 15 All-Star games and the 3,643 points and the 2008 NBA Most Valuable Player Award, and the self-certainty, a belief in himself so absolute and obvious that it practically glowed and radiated from him, required to take the final shot when everyone in the arena knows you're going to take it. And now, all that excellence and redemption and promise had been extinguished, and there was no sense of it to be made. It was barely worth trying. You sat there, and it sank in, and you gaped and shook your head. Those great things had begun in and around Philadelphia. It might not feel that way any longer, because Kobe was so much a part of Los Angeles for so long, had gone from boyhood to manhood there, always under the spotlight's glare, that it seemed as if he had sprouted as a fully formed 17-year-old, complete with exquisite jump-shooting form, out of one of Hollywood's hills. But no. The great things had begun at Lower Merion, located on the Main Line, the posh suburb that hugged Philadelphia's western border. They had begun on the courts of those neighborhoods and playgrounds and parks, in the stuffy gymnasiums of local high schools, and in the tournaments of the country's AAU circuit. Sure, many Philadelphia natives still note that Kobe technically wasn't from the city, wasn't one of them. But ask yourself, was there ever a player who better embodied what being a Philadelphia basketball player meant, what it looked like, the edginess, the kill-or-die-yourself competitiveness? It taught me how to be tough, how to have thick skin, he said in late 2015 before his final game in Philadelphia against the 76ers. There's not one playground around here where people just play basketball and don't talk trash. Those great things had begun with his high school coach, Greg Downer, who formed and was formed by Kobe, who won a championship with him too, and would love and be loyal to him forevermore, who collapsed to his kitchen floor, disbelief accelerating into despair, when the news of Kobe's death broke. Those great things had begun with Treatman, who went from covering Kobe to befriending him, from a freelance sports writer to one of Kobe's most trusted confidants, and to a mover and shaker in the world of Philly hoops. His 1992 Inquirer story would be the first mention of Kobe in any major mainstream news outlet. Remember this name? Treatman did his best to make sure that no one would forget it. He became an assistant boys basketball coach at Lower Merion at Downer's request, charged with handling the never-ending interview requests, keeping the media close, but not so close that they became a burden and a distraction, tracking the tale of Kobe's comet. He told anyone who happened to ask an offhand, casual question about Joe Bryant's son that Kobe was the next big thing, that we were all going to end up saying we knew him when, which we did. He grew so close to Kobe that the two of them collaborated on a series of interviews for a book that Treatman never got the chance to write, though he made sure to preserve the microcassette tapes and transcripts of several of those interviews. The fresh thoughts and memories of a Kobe who was not yet 20 years old and has given me access to them for this book. And then, on January 26th, Treatman answered his cell phone from Jefferson University in the East Falls section of Philadelphia, where he was overseeing a girls' basketball tournament, and he could barely get the words out. "I can't believe it," he said. Those great things had begun at a school whose boys' basketball program had faded into irrelevance years earlier, but became a traveling circus and the best team in the state because of Kobe. They had begun within a community that touted its racial and economic diversity and harmony, but whose members were in reality hungry for a common point of pride to unite them. They had begun in summer league and pickup games that instantaneously became the stuff of apocrypha and myth, and remained so for decades thereafter. Stories that didn't need to be embellished because the reality was flabbergasting enough that a kid who was just turning 17 already was the equal of, or had surpassed, the best players on those courts, which meant that he already was the equal or had surpassed some of the best players in the NBA. They had begun at practices and workouts that the Sixers would hold at St. Joseph's University in the mid-1990s, when a teenage Kobe would walk into the gym and upstage many of those NBA veterans, and Coach John Lucas could only wish that the team would have the good sense to draft the kid. As an undergrad at LaSalle then, as an editor and sports columnist for the student newspaper, I had read and heard rumors about those workouts. Like everyone else on campus who wanted to see LaSalle men's basketball return to the success, the 20-win seasons, the conference championships, the NCAA tournament berths, that had been common and perhaps taken for granted just a few years earlier, I hoped Kobe would choose to go to college and to play in the same program where his father had such strong ties. "Joe Bryant is a LaSalle alum and a LaSalle coach. He and Kobe are so close. It's meant to be, right?" But how realistic was that scenario once Kobe saw that he stacked up pretty well against pros, that they could try their sly tricks and throw their elbows, and he could not only take it, but give it right back to them? The great things had begun with that realization. They had to have begun then. They had begun at a moment in our cultural history when a traditional path to athletic stardom was seen as the only appropriate path to athletic stardom, a presumption that Kobe managed to follow and askew at the very same time. They had begun with a youth who was in some ways completely typical, and in others, unlike anything a teenager could possibly experience, a youth that seems so far away now. They had begun in December 1992, when Kobe was just 14, and look where it all had led. The brief snippet of film that Ben Rellis preserved for nearly 30 years didn't tell the game's full story. Lower Merion beat Upper Dublin 74-57, and Kobe's moment of embarrassment, captured forever as if in amber by that camcorder, was hardly representative of his overall performance. He scored 19 points, and in a 5-minute excerpt of the game that Ben later discovered, Kobe is the most arresting figure in the action. He drives into the lane and scores. He pulls up for two. He frees himself on an inbounds play and rattles in an open jumper from the left baseline. For a while, the longer video seems a highlight reel of Kobe and Kobe alone. And to watch him is to wonder how the Aces would ever lose as long as he remained in the lineup. But lose they did. Kobe was right. The team won just 3 more times while he was a freshman, finishing 4-20. More illuminating than his perfect recall of that season, though, was the look on his face as he watched the game, smiling, snickering, and cursing at himself for his lazy defense, chomping on a piece of gum, his eyes on the computer screen, but his mind searching, groping backward for that moment and that time in his life, for the prodigy he used to be. The footage clearly had surprised him, had sent him hurtling deep into his past, and if he went back far enough, he could make out the shape and contours of the mold for the man he became. The template was already in place. So many traits that shaped and characterized him were already present at that point in his life. The cockiness, the competitiveness, the warmth and the coldness that would emerge depending on the circumstances and his own desires and aims, the boyish insecurities, the comfort with fame, the beyond his years commitment to basketball brilliance, and the preternatural understanding of what it took to achieve it, the traits he had retained over time, the traits he had shed. Memory is a gift, often hidden away within a box locked tight. And that game film was the gliding turning key, allowing Kobe access to sights, sounds, places, and people made tactile and intimate again. He was seeing himself anew. What follows is an attempt to see him that way once again.
Part 1. I'm sure it seems to you like I have the perfect life right now. Kobe Bryant. 1. After the fire. Atop the gray concrete walkway, outside the entrance to Kobe Bryant Gymnasium, a makeshift memorial garden was blooming with colors and remembrances, candles and wreaths and sneakers and jerseys, maroon and white for the Lower Merion High School Aces, purple and gold for the Los Angeles Lakers, orange and brown from the basketballs, red and yellow from the roses. It had been 48 hours since a Sikorsky S-76B helicopter, its body white and stripped in royal blue and periwinkle, had lifted off from John Wayne Orange County Airport in Southern California, hovered in circles above a golf course, tried to slice through a fog bank as thick and blinding as gauze, and crashed into a hilly ravine, killing the 9 people aboard, Kobe, his 13-year-old daughter Gianna, the pilot, and 6 people involved in Kobe's AAU basketball program, including 2 of Gianna's teammates, all of them bound for a tournament at his Mamba Sports Academy, 45 miles northwest of Los Angeles. That was Sunday, January 26th, 2020. Now it was Tuesday, a crystalline afternoon in the suburbs west of Philadelphia, the middle of the school day, breezy and chilly. Students, heading from one class to another, stopped to gaze at the items and whisper among themselves. Middle-aged men and women parked their cars blocks away, then walked to the site, as quietly as if they were entering a church. A 64-year-old Lakers fan from central New Jersey, Mark Kerr, drove 90 minutes that day with his wife and nephew, just to visit the memorial, just to feel a connection to Kobe. 3 members of the school's 2006 boys basketball team, which had won a state championship 10 years after Kobe had led the school to one, set a framed photo there. In the photo was Kobe, sitting on a bench with them. A WNBA player had written a letter to him in lavender ink, in curly-cued Palmer method, on lined notepad paper. I feel selfish for just missing out on what else you would have done with your time with us. For those 2 days, Greg Downer had not watched TV, had avoided listening to any radio reports, and had not stopped once at the site. How many times had he kept his head down and kept striding past it and into the gym? How many times would he have to contemplate what he had lost, what the world had lost, in the foothills of the Santa Monica Mountains? He couldn't say, but he knew he couldn't bear to spend any time there yet. There was so much of him blanketing that ground, too. He was 57 now, his face finely wrinkled and more weathered than it had been when he and Kobe were together, when he was in his early 30s, and so boyish that the two of them could have been mistaken for college roommates. They were so close, knew each other so well, respected each other so much that they might as well have been. In his kitchen on the morning and early afternoon of that Sunday, Downer had been overseeing a playdate between his daughter, Bryn, who was 7, and one of her friends. Whenever Kobe saw Bryn, toe-headed and pigtailed, he scooped her up, nuzzled her face, and squeezed her tight as if she were his own, as if she were his 5th daughter. Downer had not become a father until he was 50, until after Kobe and Vanessa had already had 2 girls, Natalia and Gianna. There was always a gleam in Bryn's eyes, Downer noticed, whenever she saw Kobe, and the gleam in his when he saw her. But now Bryn and her friend were padding past Downer and his wife, Colleen, and Downer's phone was buzzing. A reporter. Downer guessed why he'd been getting such a call. The night before, in Philadelphia against the Sixers, LeBron James had moved.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.